Generally in psychology, when we ask people a question, then they might start to think consciously about that question. And that's always a problem when you do research and want to understand concepts better. Now, obviously your eyes, they're more difficult to control consciously. And so your eye movements are a more natural way of investigating or studying where people are looking when they're doing a certain task. I'm Dr. Jo Van Herwegen, and I'm a lecturer here in psychology at Kingston University.
What we're doing is we're showing a cat.
Yeah.
And if he knows the difference between a cat, then we'll say, we'll show him cat, 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 until he goes like, okay, I'm really bored with cats. And then we change the picture to a cat and a bird. And if he knows the difference, the idea is that he would look longer at the bird then.
He's always looking around and looking at new things, a bit nosy.
Infants learn from where adults are looking, to learn about objects, to learn about all the different things, about face recognition, about emotion, understanding. So this is why eyes have been called the window of the soul. But the idea obviously is that infants, the first thing they see when they're born is, you know, their mother's face very often. Yes, they start recognizing faces from a very early age onwards, so a few weeks old, a few hours old. We make an infant used to a certain image, such as cat, and actually we make them bored at the end with the image of cat. And the idea is that when we then present a baby with something new, the baby should regain interest and look longer again at a new object.
So these are his eyes, basically, where they're looking on the screen. That's what we're looking at. In the end, we'll see when there's the two different pictures, we can then see whether he looks longer at a bird compared to the cat. And that's what we're interested in, because if he looks longer at a bird, it means he can see the difference between a bird and a cat, knows the difference between the concepts.
So with babies, what we learn from it is that it's what they can do at a much younger age before they can start to talk and explain to us what they know and what they think. We can also look at children with autism, for example, to see that when they do something, a task that they're not doing very well. Why are they failing? What are they doing differently? And eye movements can tell us a lot. So for example, we're learning that children with autism sometimes look more at the mouth compared to the eyes, but also that sometimes they look more at the background in pictures rather than the foreground. And obviously that all has very big implications for interventions, but also for education and so that we can actually start to help children as well. There are more people who are starting to use eye tracking because it is so interesting and easy to use actually as well. So we've got students using it for their research as well. If I had the money, what I would like to do is to combine the eye movements, but also looking at brain studies at the same time. So that, you know, for example, in a scanner, so you not only know where people are looking on a screen, but also what their brain is doing at that same time. I think that's will help us to understand more about the brain and how it works. We're not just doing behavioral research that everyone can do, so we're becoming quite specialized, and I think that's very important for Kingston.